Good morning, San Francisco, and welcome to the fourth day of the first Dutch virtual trade mission on smart and e-mobility. It's 7:45 in the morning here in San Francisco, and I'm happy to see you again. If you have any questions, please leave them in the chat box below your viewer. And if you want to post about this on social media, please do use the hashtag NLUSA, hashtag Digitale Missie, and tag us, the Consulate General in San Francisco, with at NLinSF. Good morning, Gerbert.
Good morning, Sietse.
So today we're going to talk a bit more about how to find the right business contacts here in Silicon Valley. Now, the consulate has started this wonderful network, Holland in the Valley. How does that work? What is it exactly?
Well, Holland in the Valley is a network of Dutch and American entrepreneurs, government, academia. And the objective is to tap into the latest tech developments here in Silicon Valley and to be, well, helped to get your soft landing realized. Hence, a very useful network for all the participants, I would say.
So, but how does it work? Because there's so much going on here in San Francisco, in Silicon Valley. Where do people start?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think the good thing here is that it's sort of, the feel is paying forward. Everybody's here to help, and I think we tap into that. So we have wonderful companies that are our company's partners, and they are companies like Shell, Adyen, Palo Alto Networks. They're willing to really help us set the next steps. And as well, we have the close connection to the universities in the Netherlands, VSNU, the Dutch Association of Universities. And in the end, of course, it's all about the tailor-made kind of mentoring. So you have a wonderful network of mentors, all gathered together in a network platform. And actually, let's ask one of these mentors, because we have today with us Maaike Dooijer from Business Model Inc. Maaike, good morning.
Good morning.
So, well, I think many of the participants have maybe seen you already in the preparation of videos. What's your role in Holland in the Valley?
So I am a member of the Holland in the Valley Entrepreneurship Committee. And I think I can say I've been also part of the start of this whole initiative. I remember many Dutch companies coming over and were like, hey, how do we do this? How can we make everyone successful? As you said, Gerbert, like buy all these Dutch entrepreneurs that are already here. And one example is the Silicon Valley Playbook. I'm sure this is already part of your virtual goodie bag. So if you haven't read this yet, make sure you do.
Well, thanks. And how would you describe the added value? Because like Sietse was saying, there's so much going on in Silicon Valley. What is the added value of this Holland in the Valley network?
And so when I arrived here in San Francisco 5 years ago, I must say, to be honest, I sort of ignored everything Dutch. I was like, I moved. I want to immerse myself in this new world. But what I realized a couple of months in, my network was definitely not going fast enough. And I really learned that being in touch with fellow Dutchies in the Valley really made a difference for me. The network effect that is so important here in the Valley is so different compared to the Netherlands. And what's amazing right now for all these newcomers, there is this platform, there is this mentor platform that is launched, and you will really be surprised what the power is of this network. So utilize it to the max. It will absolutely help you to become successful in the Valley.
Well, thank you so much, Maaike. And I'm pretty sure participants would like to reach out to you. And of course, we will be connected through the interactive platform. And thanks for being so early this morning. Thank you. So I now would like to turn to Mark Sawaki. You are as well a mentor in this wonderful Holland in the Valley network. You are a Silicon Valley-based business strategist, a keynote speaker, investor. Welcome, Mark. Good to see you again. And I know you've been around. You are founder of, I have to say, 650, since it's the phone number in Silicon Valley. Well, perhaps you could say and give your opinion on the secret of Silicon Valley.
Great question, Herbert. And thanks for having me this morning. And good afternoon, everyone, or good evening, everyone in the Netherlands. It's probably not one thing. I think of five or six things, but in no particular order. There's this giant network. It's very, very large. It's very interactive. It's quite complex. I mean, you obviously have the VCs and the entrepreneurs and the academics, but you have all kinds of other service providers around that, you know, lawyers that have taken companies public and marketing experts and, you know, business model experts. Mike is here. Just on and on. But it's a very, very complex system, ecosystem. Secondarily, and I encourage the Dutch listeners to really think about big things. Silicon Valley isn't solving problems for 20 million people. right? It's solving problems for the 3.5 billion people online or the 7.8 billion people that wake up every day and breathe, right? That's a very, very different mindset than solving problems for 20 million people.
Wow, yeah. And I was just thinking, because of the COVID-19, of course, we're all concerned, and we were thinking, what's the impact on Silicon Valley? I mean, is it business as usual, or do we all do the calls to our investors by Zoom? What's the current situation here?
Great question. It's great for Zooms and Zoom stock, right? Look, the last quarter of a year, we've been in this 3 months, I see a massive diffusion, right? We're calling it remote working, but I see teams being more distributed. I see venture being more distributed. The money's going to follow that and be more distributed. You know, we saw where Twitter said we're closing our San Francisco office. I think this is a net negative for Silicon Valley, and it becomes a net positive for the Netherlands. Once these businesses decide to let a lot of their workers work remote, becomes a standard benefit, and all companies adopt that. So that's going to just accelerate this kind of diffusion. So net is it's not as important, I think, to be here for the next 5 years than say it has been in the last 20.
So what do you think is the outlook for investments then? I mean, given this economic downturn, of course.
So it's been a dramatic pullback. We're seeing funds say year to date, they're off about 50% on their investment pace. And I think what you're seeing there is they're worried about their current portfolio, right? They've got dozens of current investments that need their attention. They have to make sure that those investments are making the right financial decisions and have the right cash to survive. They're also concerned that corporates are going to slow down their pace of investment in buying technology in the next couple of years. So the last thing on their mind right now is looking at new investments.
Yeah, well, thank you. And I will come back to you, Mark, just in a second. But first, I would like to turn to Constantine Demetrio of Hart Hyperloop. He is one of the participants of this trade mission. And please, Constantine, could you share your experience with this virtual trade mission? I mean, is it a helpful tool for you?
Absolutely. I think I've been very impressed by the mission. To be honest, I had two priorities that I wanted to achieve in this mission. One is to expand my network of investors that I know and I'm speaking with in relation to Hart, and second, business development. To be honest, to be able to hit one of those points would have been great. And especially with Holland in the Valley, with the help of Michael Dewis, we've been able to achieve that objective. At the same time, I've also enjoyed some of the sessions. I would have liked to attend all of them, but to be honest, I attended part of them. As a result, I do like the mission. I think it's been extremely helpful for us. So I'm certainly looking forward to the next one.
Well, thank you. I was just wondering, what is it that Hyperloop does? I mean, what is your business actually? Because, of course, this is maybe more a future thing or like also a current kind of service. How would you describe your company?
That's a great question. So Hart is the leading European Hyperloop company. It was established 4 years ago by four co-founders who actually won the first Hyperloop competition that Elon Musk organized in California. Since then, we've developed a lot. We have a test center in the Netherlands. We're building another test center that's a high-speed test center. And we're very focused on cargo and later passenger Hyperloop transport. So it's something that is applicable in the Netherlands, in Europe, in California, and worldwide. It's a sustainable method of transport. And because we are focused on the cargo element first, we will believe that we will be the first Hyperloop company to market.
Well, I mean, we have a short video now. It looks amazing. Constantine, I know you have a question for Mark as well, being an investor and so well aware of what's going on in Silicon Valley. Please go ahead.
Well, my question is, obviously, Silicon Valley is like the shrine of venture capital investors. Now, at the same time, the kind of the highlight stories are very much focused on internet or apps. Now, to our daily lives, infrastructure is key, and having the opportunity to develop new infrastructure and to raise financing for it is something that's very important globally. So my question is, to what extent do the funds in Silicon Valley over the last few years have tended to be more interested in infrastructure, or is it still sort of the app is king mentality is there?
Constantine, great question. I think the short answer is the latter. I think it's still enterprise software driven, looking at the next trends around AI or ML, robotics. You know, they'll dive into healthcare. I was going to come back and have a conversation with you about, you know, what are your forward funding needs? Because I suspect they're an order of magnitude larger than, you know, typical Silicon Valley style venture fund, right? They might put in, you know, $5 million a Series A and, you know, hope for the best, and your Series B is $20 million. But, you know, I suspect your funding is going to require public partnerships. It's going to require probably very deep pockets from private equity and some probably a different lineup of investors to ultimately get this off the ground. Only what I know from the numbers I've seen earlier from the Hyperloop project from LA to San Francisco.
I mean, if I try and answer that, so because we are a Dutch startup, we're actually quite economical with money. So that's our advantage, to be honest. In terms of the projects themselves, the projects will require quite large amounts of money. But the cargo projects will require a lot less because the size of the tube is smaller. A passenger Hyperloop is 4 meter diameter tube. Cargo is 1.8. As a result, the cost of construction is a lot easier. Nevertheless, the funding that we're raising now is for Heart itself. The funding for the project is going to come from a completely different class of investor. And actually, for those investors, having a sustainable infrastructure investment, it is a rarity, because there's actually very limited investments in sustainable infrastructure out there. I mean, the sort of the boilerplates are solar and wind parks, and that's become a commodity because it's just very competitive, and there's nothing there for the investors. So we believe we have something that is a very interesting product, not only for the end consumer, so for the people that will use the Hyperloop, the logistics companies, but also for the infrastructure investor market.
Right. Yeah, please, Mark, go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, we can go offline. It's a deeper conversation. I'm sure Michael Duyas can put us in touch, but there's probably at least a half a dozen larger venture funds that historically were on Sand Hill Road but have a European presence. So they're investing out of both Europe and North America. They can write large checks. So if this is a proof of concept and it's, say, sub 100 million that you need to really hit some large milestones with, I'd say there are probably funds that would take a look, but they're gonna know how to spell Europe, and they probably have passports, which few VCs do, right? They're very myopic and they're very centered on, you know, a 40-mile radius around Sand Hill Road.
Yeah. Well, great. Well, let's continue this talk. I think we'd just like to say that Michael Doyes has been mentioned. He's our startup liaison officer here in the consulate. And of course, he would love to continue to help Constantine and to connect you to Mark. You're already connected, and hopefully soon, maybe you can meet even in real life. So thanks again. Tsitsa, over to you.
Thank you, Gerbert. I have a couple of announcements for the participants of this virtual trade mission. Today, it's time for swipe left, swipe right. It's time to have your first Tinder date with other participants. There are some 30 matches, and you can call your match in the next hour or so through the platform. And right after this show, our colleague Deborah will give a short instruction about the matching section on this platform. So just stay tuned, and she'll explain how you can connect and call with the other participants. Don't forget to fill out the online survey on the platform. It gives us a lot of intel on what you think of this virtual mission and if it's a tool that has been useful for you. And then let's go over the program of today. So we started with Good Morning San Francisco, and we'll continue on this live stream into an introduction on swipe left, swipe right, and then you can go to the platform and connect to your fellow participants. It says it's on Zoom, but that's not the case. And then after that, there's a fourth webinar that you can also join. That's it for now. We'll be back tomorrow with the last day of this virtual trade mission. I hope you enjoy your day. Bye.